Welcome in HR Khan, former Deputy Governor of Reserve Bank of India. Mr. Khan, thank you so much indeed for joining us. You were among the first who expressed your reservations about what's likely to happen to LCs, or rather letters of comfort and letters of undertaking when the PNB scam first broke out. What is your reading of this? Is the Reserve Bank of India guilty of throwing the baby out with the bathwater?
No, they must have thought through the whole thing and the way that instrument has been abused in this particular case, more out of operation risk failure. But then the instrument has got a bad name. And in the past also, there have been reports people using it for arbitrage games. And overseas investors and certain centers also had their views there.
Okay, we seem to have lost that line with Mr. Khan. We'll come back to him in just a bit. But Vishwanath, just the sort of the differentiation, right? How does this thing work? Why has this been a more popular tool so far?
I mean, I don't know about popular, because in our conversations with the exporters, importer community, as well as some of the bankers, these were largely used by smaller companies and largely in the gold import segment. Mm. While that may as be, the difference between an LOU and LC here is that the buyer comes into the picture whenever an LOU is involved. Mm-hmm. So the buyer or the importer who is based out of India, essentially the person who negotiates with this foreign bank, negotiates with the domestic bank, gets an LOU done, mm-hmm. and then gets his product from whoever is exporting it from abroad. Mm-hmm. In the LC infrastructure, what typically happens is mm-hmm. banks deal with each other. The buyer's mm-hmm. bank and the seller's bank only talk to each other. Mm-hmm. The money is settled between the two of them, and then the importer gets whatever delivery of the products he's due to receive. So that is the difference, and that, you know, as the structure will tell you, mm. has fewer chances of it being misused or, you know, some kind of fraudulent transactions taking place through that infrastructure
as opposed to an LOU
or
we got Mr. Khan back on the line. Sorry, Mr. Khan, we lost you. Please go ahead and complete your point. You were talking about the ramifications of this ban.
No, what I was telling this since they were. There are also reports about people playing arbitrage game using this. But also the positive side was that it was providing cheaper funds to Indian exporters, importers, because many exporters are also importers, and they were getting dollar funding. But then if you misuse certain instrument, then possibly you have to face the consequence. But I wish we could have planned a transition a little better, because in the immediate context, setting the LC limit, getting the sellers to agree for a long-term LC, this may cause a problem. So possibly a transition path could have helped. But then given the normative situation, probably RBI would have thought that let us go for a
Mr. Khan, this is Vishwanath. Just a day before this announcement came in, the RBI also said that LCs can only be maximum for a year. So do you think that possibly that setting that 1 year deadline would make sense here, because now that it become the primary tool?
Operating cycle. So it should for arbitrage game. So that must be the thinking behind that.
Mm. Sure, sir.
Okay, I have also Mr. RK Bakshi joining us from the former executive director of Bank of Baroda. Mr. Bakshi, thank you so much for joining in as well. What have you made of this move by the Reserve Bank of India to go ahead and ban it entirely? That is LOUs and letters of comfort. What are the options before an importer today, particularly the small importer?
See, I don't know how many very small importers were actually using LOUs. Mm. Very small importers importing normal goods or their non-capital goods, maybe doing it through letters of credit, which may be either payable on demand or payable after 90 or 180 days. Mm. Who placed model of their customers and are ready to issue LOU. LC is also a similar document, which they give, if they are ready to take a credit risk on the customer for 90 or 180 days, they can give LC also. Mm. In LC is a more monitorable document. LOU has its own distinct benefits. Mm. But LC, from risk management perspective, is a more monitorable document, because you get the documents of title to goods in that, and invoice, which must be submitted by the exporter to the exporter's bank and then flow to the importer's bank through the normal channel. So there's more control on the transaction. Mm.
Was the ban the only alternative before the Reserve Bank, sir? Particularly that this could cause near-term disruption for importers. Was there any other easier way out? Was there probably greater regulation of it? Was that a likely option too?
I cannot step into the regulator's mind, and in their space to comment on that, they might have more data points than I have access to, and they must have taken a decision in totality. Of course, the event that has gone before has been very shocking for the country. It has really brought such a mammoth loss to the industry and loss of confidence.
Okay.
That regulator's action was impending.
Okay.
Whether this or that is a question, but that the people will be starved of credit or options may not necessarily be the case, because it is a working capital assessment of the borrower which is done.
Okay.
And then it may be met either by giving them a direct lending in rupees here, or giving them letters of credit, or giving them SBLC, or giving them an LOU. So the LOUs, only the bank should now take care that they should facilitate smooth transition from LOU-based regime to LC-based regime.
Okay, let me go back to Mr. Khan on this. Sir, what, you know, was this the best option on the table for the Reserve Bank of India? What do you think will be the near-term disruptions that's likely?
This has happened. This could possibly affect dollar flows. And since most of the importers, many of them are exporters, will now more rely on rupee funds, which cost is high. So it may, at margin, it may affect export competitiveness, and cost of imports may go up. But then since it has happened, I think the banks, and maybe through RBI, they should little proactively try to help the customer and set up lines for LCs, and that transition should be made as smooth as possible, because setting up a LC limit and making the borrowers, the suppliers agree is a challenge. So that needs to be faced quickly and squarely. So I think that's the best option at the current junction. As Mr. Bakshi rightly said, one of the major problems is that, and it has also been highlighted by Dr. Rajan recently, is in the non-fund-based business, the standard of appraisal, standard of diligence, standard of underwriting has not been to the extent it is required under funded exposure. So I think there is a need to tighten this, the underwriting standards as well as monitoring part of it. I think that is also important. And the last point I would like to make before I have to catch a flight is that I think this entire amount which banks have been exposed to, that should be settled quickly in best possible manner, so that the confidence in banking system, particularly overseas financial centers, are restored as quickly as possible. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. HR Khan, for joining us. Mr. Bakshi, my last question to you. You know, you mentioned to what this would mean for cost of credit for importers. It is inevitable now that they will have to opt for sort of higher cost options. What do you think are the implications out of this? Do you see sort of the overall imports reducing? Are banks turning importers away? What's the sense that you're getting?
No, I don't think banks will be turning importers away. A bank, as I said, a holistic working capital limit is assessed for the borrower, and borrower is considered credit worthy, and then the limits are placed at his disposal. Then there will be sublimits. There will be a sublimit for LOU or LC or cash credit and all. So the credit risk is accepted by the bank. So now they have to shift from LOU to LC or rupee funding.
Okay.
That is one thing where the cost can go up. And LOU, the benefit to the customer was that he could be, his supplier's bank may be X, but X may not be ready to discount the bills at a competitive rate. So this person could, importer could go shopping around and get the discounting done not from the supplier's bank, but from a new bank altogether at a very concessional rate. That will not be available. But having said that, still, funding in dollars or funding in foreign currency at cheaper rates compared to rupee is possible if the banks open LCs for 180 days or 360 days and permit the customers to discount from the supplier's bank, which may be slightly costlier than LOU, but may be much less costlier than the rupee credit.